Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, you are the living light, who transformed darkness into light through the blessings of this glorious Sunday. Make us worthy to praise you with all those who saw the radiant light of your resurrection. We worship and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and your children.
Thank you.
Spirit, For the letter brings death, and the spirit gives life. Praise be to God.
So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest. Go on your way. Behold, I am sending you like lambs among wolves. Carry no money bag, no sack, no sandals, and greet no one along the way. Into whatever house you enter, first say, "Peace be to this house." If a son of peace lives there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. Stay in the same house and eat and drink what is offered to you. For the laborer is worthy of his hire. Do not move about from one house to another. This is the truth. Peace be with you. Continual turning towards our Lord that we need to do which means that we turn away from our own selfishness and our sins. And of course, the ramifications of not converting, the ramifications of not turning toward the Lord, is sin. And sin brings disorder, it brings separation from God, it brings anarchy, it brings insecurity, and ultimately destruction. That is also linked with Fatima today. But today is the feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. And Carmel stands out because it's actually a range of mountains in northern Israel. And like the Lebanon that we use in the singular, it's actually a chain of mountains. And so Mount Carmel is actually a number of mountains in this range. And it's associated with the plains of Sharon. The plains of Sharon in the Old Testament are known for and are symbolic of the blessings of God in abundance and fruitfulness. So Our Lady of Mount Carmel stands out as an indication to us, as a prophecy associated with Elijah and Elisha, who lived in these mountains as prophets centuries before our Lord. And Elisha actually has a vision of a cloud which comes from the sea over the mountains, and which the fathers have always interpreted as being the image of the coming of the Mother of God, Mary of Nazareth. And this cloud gave forth rain, as Mary of Nazareth gave forth the Word of God incarnate. And so Our Lady of Mount Carmel is associated for centuries before the coming of the Christ. And so, of course, we have the modern-day religious order of the Carmelites, who will trace themselves back to these hermits living in the mountains of Mount Carmel. Now, when we look at the Gospel of St. Luke today, we are once again in these weeks of considering the apostolate and the apostolic life, at the moment in which our Lord sends out not the apostles. That's the first missionary journey set out in chapter 9 by St. Luke. And there he sends out the 12, again, 2 by 2. Now he sends out 70. 70 men who go out from village to town and all the places where our Lord intends to come himself eventually and to preach the kingdom of God. These 70 are a link with us in the establishment of the kingdom of God, which is not only the whole entire work of redemption in the church, but also, of course, is meant to initiate the whole life of the beatific vision ultimately for us. Now, 70 is chosen because 70 makes a reference to the 70 elders that Moses chose on Mount Sinai that form what we now know as the Sanhedrin. These were the elders, these were the elder statesmen, if you want. They became statesmen to lead Israel. But 70 is also hearkening back to a larger mission of the Messiah for the whole world. So on one aspect is an image of Israel being fulfilled in the coming of the Messiah. But we also have the larger mission in reference to the book of Genesis, chapter 10. And in Genesis, we're given the origins and the development of 70 nations. Not Israel, not included in the list. Israel is created by God himself directly on Mount Sinai. But the 70 nations of the known world at the time, which of course is laying out the foundation and anticipating the church's mission and its Catholicity to all the world. So both of these are being referenced in the number of 70 that go out. The other thing that I want to mention, or at least to call to your attention, is this reference to Shlomo, to peace. And we've talked about this before. In the Syriac, the word shalom, very obviously related to the Hebrew word shalom, is a word indicating peace, but also peace of order, harmony, well-being, integrity, wholeness, health. And so what our Lord is saying to these men is, you have a purpose to accomplish. And on the road, you are not to give greeting. You are not to wish peace, shalom, to anyone along the way. You're not to ask about their children, their cousins, their second cousins, and everyone else in their family, as all the Middle East to this day still does. You're there for an hour. This makes reference to what we spoke about last week of the ihidoyutho, the singularity of vision. Our Lord is sending them out on a specific mission. You are to accomplish this work exclusively. And so you are not to grant peace to anyone on the road. Don't talk to them. Don't take extra money. No extra credit cards. No traveler's checks. Nothing. No extra sandals. No sack. No extra. You have immediately what you need, and the people will take care of you in the villages. That's why he makes reference. You stay in the household. You eat what they put before you. And don't be moving around, gossiping, and finishing up. You have things to do. Stay at the one house. In fact, it goes on to say, and if the village doesn't receive you, you exit that village, you take off your sandals, and you shake the very dust off of your sandals to leave it behind because they have rejected the preaching of the kingdom of God. Pretty austere. And it seems negative, but the notion, the Hebraic notion, the Old Testament notion, the Syriac notion, of peace, of shalom, is something which comes forth and gives benediction and blessing. It confers something. So there's references in the Old Testament of God's blessing coming forth from Him, returning fruitful and all this. It is the same notion here with the establishment of the kingdom of God, which is why then our Lord goes on to say, and if you enter a house and there is Baal Shlomo, there is a son of peace who is present. Like we have the son of man, Bara Adon. In the Syriac terminology, I mean in our lecture we haven't translated a person, but the term is Bara. Bara is a reference in the Syriac linguistically, culturally, conceptually, that when we link Bara with the word, it shows an affinity and a relation between the two. So for an example, in the Gospel, we have the instance in which the Pharisees come to our Lord and they accuse Him of black magic. You do these things because you're in consort with Beelzebub. You work with Satan to accomplish these wonders. And of course, our Lord then goes on famously to say, house divided against house will always fall. And so if this is done by Beelzebub, then soon he'll be finished, etc. But he uses the term by saying, if you say that I do this by the demons, then in these exorcisms and wonders that you accomplish, what do your children say? Now, children is not referring to their biological children, but again, it's this term, Bar. And it's saying that they are the disciples, they are the followers, they are the extension of you. What do your students say then? You turn around and accuse me of working wonders and it can only be by black magic. Then what do your children, what do your students say of you? Now what is interesting here, of course, what we're saying is that the Bar Shlomo is a person. That this man of peace is someone who is seeking harmony, who is seeking integrity, who is seeking shalom, who is seeking wholeness. Remember our sign of peace. There is a very specific theological idea for us doing this at the beginning of the anaphora. But think of all the times in the opening prayer that we have references. Let us think of peace. Let us accomplish peace. Let us seek peace. This is Bar Shalom, to become the children of peace. To show an affinity of one who seeks and one who desires to accomplish and to be a vehicle of shalom. And our Lord says that if you enter this house and there is a person here who is of this affinity, then your peace, peace be to this house, that shalom that you grant to this house by your vehicle of the kingdom of God will rest upon you. But if not, then your peace will return to you. It's a very significant thing, and it links directly, in fact, with our whole message of Fatima for this month. In July of 1917, World War I had reached the proportions of complete and sheer insanity. just trainloads of young men being thrown in to be machine gunned down, drowned in mud trenches, blown up, gassed, everything else. Of course, you know famously or infamously the Battle of Verdun, in which there are 800,000 young men who are just simply carted in and killed week after week. And in the end of this battle, the front line had changed all of about 3 yards. Hundreds of thousands being killed. World War I is indicative of a world that had already very much separated itself from God, had been doing so for generations. We are only that much more progressed another century later of that separation from God and the clarity of mind, and specifically today of Shlomo, of peace. So on July 13th, 1917, it arrives on a Friday. Now Friday, of course, for most of the Catholic world, for most of its history, would immediately tell us crucifixion, day of penance. And of course, for most of us, much of our lives, that penance was abstinence from meat. We still do it during Lent. But it used to be every single Friday of the year. And what most Catholics don't understand is that in the 1960s, when everything really just became collapsing and falling down, one of the things that was specified was you don't have to abstain from meat any longer on Fridays. Specify what kind of penance. Now, most of us know that. But what most Catholics don't know is that in that directive, Friday always remains a day of penance, of a serious obligation. The only thing that happened in the 1960s was to say it doesn't have to be abstinence from meat. But it means something else serious. You say an extra rosary. You do the Stations of the Cross. You do something to commemorate the death of the Lord God on Calvary for our redemption and for the reception of Shlomo, of peace. And that's considered a serious obligation. From the 1960s, many of us don't do anything on Fridays anymore. We've lost that notion. So as a reminder, that July 13th in 1917 was on a Friday, because this is actually one of the most horrific of the apparitions. This is the occasion in which the Mother of God shows to a 7-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 10-year-old a vision of hell. So when they come to the place, what is significant about this, as I mentioned to you, in June of 1917, there were about 50 people who arrived with children. In July of 1917, there's two things that take place. One, that 50 people has ballooned to about 2,000. Even without Twitter or emails or anything, the word gets around, and when the children arrive, there's about 2,000 people with them. The other significant change is their parents are there. Not because they believe. Lucia's mother distinctly remains hostile to this whole thing. But she comes with her daughter. But the Marto, Mr. and Mrs. Marto, the parents of the brother and sister, Jacinta and Francisco, they come, and the mother is beginning to think that perhaps there's something here. But it's their father, Manuel Pedro, who does believe that something really is happening here. And he's here to protect the children in case something goes wrong. But he knows that something is happening here. He believes what the children are telling him. And he is the one that says he sees something like a small cloud that comes down and hovers over this bush in Fatima. Now, of course, harkening back to our image of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, the cloud that comes from the sea to bring the blessings. And what begins at this apparition is Lucia begins to go pale. As the children then begin to speak with the Lady of Light. And she tells them once again, come next month on the 13th. And this is going to be important because of what is actually going to happen in August, which is rather dramatic. But she tells them to come on the 13th next month and to continue to pray the rosary each day for the conversion of sinners and for peace, for Shlomo.
When she speaks of Fatima, she speaks of two things: the ending of the war, the cessation of hostility, which is usually what we call peace these days. But this is not what she's speaking about here. She's not talking about the war. That you pray the rosary each day for peace, for shalom, for health, for well-being, for harmony, for integrity. And then she tells the children, in October, there will be a miracle so that everyone will know that what I tell you is true. So she announces already the miracle to come up, which famously Fatima is most well known for. Then she tells the children that you continue to propagate devotion to my Immaculate Heart, this heart of a mother. Sometimes we forget that aspect of Fatima. And this devotion is necessary for the conversion of sinners. This is 1917. That they should come to a mother's heart which is pure and unstained. That's what immaculate means. For their conversion, to turn them away from their selfishness and their sinfulness, to bring about the conversion of sinners. Then she opens her hands in front of the children, and the light which goes out from her opens up the ground. And she gives to these little children, for the people who think in the modern world that we can't talk about serious things, the Mother of God herself gave a vision of hell and all the damned and the demons in this, as they called it, the sea of fire. And they speak of it as wind, as snow being whipped around. Of course, being in Maine, you know this very well. Think of your whiteouts. Think of all the snow and the flakes being whipped around in chaos. And they said, that is the number. And in this sea of fire, we're plunged into this fire where all the demons and the souls of the lost, and they were, as it were, red hot coals. So think of this at your next barbecue, as you stand over with your burgers, looking at the coals, pulsating with that red fire throughout all of them. They're still coals, they're still one piece, but you still see them pulsating with the fire in them. They said, this is the damned. This is what they see of the demons and of the souls of the lost, of those who put other things than God in the center of their lives. That's the vision which brings about great horror to these children, obviously. But it's also the reason why from this day forward, Jacinta and Francisco, for the next 2 years of their short lives, the next year and a half, before they died in the flu epidemic that killed millions of people around the world, they do penance each day for the conversion of sinners, because they saw the effects of sin on that day. And they understood that sin was real, and they understood that the obligations were real, and they understood that damnation and hell were real. And then Our Lady tells them, if people respond to my requests, then many souls will be saved. And there will be peace. Again, not merely a cessation of dropping bombs. That's a very limited and very, really, the minimal amount of idea of peace. But of the order, integrity, and wholeness. But if people respond, next week then we will talk about, and if they do not respond to this message, what the effects are. So we have to divide it up this week just for length of time. But let us then return to the Mother of Mount Carmel. Our Lady of Mount Carmel, renew that resolution that at least during this centennial year, we will pray those 5 decades of the Rosary each day. It is 20 minutes out of 24 hours. Is that not a bargain? And as Our Lady says, that if people respond to these requests, many souls will be saved, and there will be peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
We believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, honored the Father before all ages, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. As I was the Spirit, was his command from the Virgin Mary, and he became man. For our sake, Jesus was God, and his conscious God. He suffered death and was buried.
Offering. Amen.
to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord God and Father, holy and glorious is your name. You deliver those who love you from all that is contrary to your will. May we who have remained in your divine love be made worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with all holy kids. May we always speak words of peace, think of peace, and work for peace. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we raise glory to you and to your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Oh,
In your mercy, you sent your only Son into the world for our salvation. He dawned on the Holy Virgin like a ray of light from a bright cloud. He took the form of a slave, yet truly he is the Son of your majesty. He willingly became man to make us divine. He was born from a woman's womb, that we may be born again from a spiritual womb. He became our brother, so that through his grace we may become your children and heirs. He took us from being slaves and made us your children. He promised us a share in the reward that allows us to call you Abba, Father. He cleansed us from our sins with his precious blood that he poured out for us, for he is your only Son. Kyrie eleison. Ma biano haudacum harsho dilema bempaien. En sabel ahma vida corifocum.
Rather, because of your holy name, by which we
mercy upon us. In your compassion, you have made us worthy of the gift of your forgiving body and blood. So make us worthy to be one with you in holiness, as you are one with your Father. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying,
Stephen the Archdeacon and first martyr, and all who pleased you
committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will, that in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Yes.
giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord. Have compassion and mercy, O Lord. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these your gifts and graces and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies and your blood with our souls for the pardon of faults and the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. You are blessed. Your kingdom is holy. And we raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you. O God the Father, we bow before you and entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your grace, to rest your right hand full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by the cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Now, I don't know if you've noticed that we had this during the whole Mass, we've had this red veil over here. During the NAM convention, there was a distribution to each of the parish churches a small relic, or some of the bones, fragments of the bones from the Vesakhi brothers who were killed in 1860 in Damascus on July 10th. And so they are gifts from the Archbishop of Damascus, Samir Massad, who you will certainly hear about from me in the future, and from one of the laymen who helped him have all of these reliquaries put together. So in the times that I'm back from NAM, we had to make sure we got a reliquary to put the smaller reliquary inside. So this will always be staying on the altar by this cross here in the center.
so that this reliquary will always remind you the presence and be, in a sense, through the relics, a presence of the Blessed Vasakhi brothers. Now, before we finish, also with NAM, there is annually members of the NAM conference who are honored for the work that they have done in the parishes, which has been outstanding and significant, of being recognized by NAM, by the eparchy, by the bishop, by the pastors, for the work that has been done. So on this occasion today, though it's a bit delayed, these would normally have been done in April, we'd like to confer the certificate and the pins upon both Mark and Lori Mann. So for their outstanding work with the endowment, the work that they have done with Lori, her work with the sacristy, the unification of the church around us, Mark is working so diligently to establish a solid financial foundation for the future of St. Joseph's. And so, if you'd like to come up to the bima, we have both the certificate and the blessing of the medals which come with this.
The nourishment and blessings you receive from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the
blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.